Just wanted to see how many people are joining you actually.
Yeah, as of now we are 79.
I could see.
Yeah.
So how many are expected to join?
Actually, today there are 11 medical colleges. List has been provided for 11 medical colleges. And let's see, we are expecting around 100 or so.
Okay, that's good.
So, should we start, Sujit? Ask.
Any, you please start. I just come over here. Just wanted to see.
Sure,
That's
sir. Most
all.
welcome.
Nothing more than that. Okay. Please start.
Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon, everyone. On behalf of Department of Anesthesiology, SGPGIMS, I would like to welcome you all in this capacity building program for the patient care and management of COVID patients. First of all, I would like to request Professor Anil Agrawal, head of the Department of Anesthesiology, SGPGI, to give us a brief introduction and layout of this program. He is also the nodal officer of this program. Sir, Dr. Anil.
Yeah. So first of all, I would like to welcome you all to this capacity building program for SDU Care. This is an initiative of Department of Anesthesia, SGPGI, Lucknow. We have been doing similar kind of programs for our faculty of SGPGI, for residents and staff nurses since September 2020, around more than 9 months as of now. And this is the second program which is being done for the state of Uttar Pradesh. And I am immensely thankful to our director, sir, Professor Dhiman, for encouraging us all through. And he is the only person who was instrumental, and he pushed us to, why don't you do it for UP also? So, and at the same time, I would also like to thank our director at the additional director at the Directorate of Medical Education, Dr. Prajapati, and then Dr. Sujit, and the rest of my faculty members of my department for the successful conduct of these programs, which are being targeted to 52 medical colleges of state of Uttar Pradesh. Today, we are joined by the faculty and residents from 11 medical colleges of UP, that is Bahraich Medical College, GIMC, Noida, Kannauj, SNMC Agra, Ayodhya, Badaun, Azamgarh, Banda, Eta, MLB Medical College, Jhansi, and SSP HP, Noida. Agenda of this program is actually, as you all are aware, that the second wave is receding as of now. And now we are getting ready for the third wave, which is expected to be somewhere in the later part of 2021 and is also expected to be of a more severe. So our aim is to hit the ground running so that we would be able to handle the third wave in a much better way with minimal of damage. The program details for today are as follows. It would be a 2.5 hours online course where we shall discuss practical tips pertaining to SDU management of COVID positive patients. And it would include decision-making tree for oxygen therapy, use of face mask, high-frequency nasal cannula, NIV, BiPAP, which will be dealt by Dr. Pratik. This would be followed by SGPGI COVID-19 management protocol by Dr. Alok Nath. Thereafter, we'll touch upon how to operate HFNC by Tapas, Dr. Tapas. This would be followed by how to operate BiPAP by Dr. Divya Srivastava. Then we'll touch upon ABG interpretation by Dr. Devendra Gupta. And this would be followed by practical tips for use of vasopressor infusions by Dr. Amit Rastogi. And a link would be sent on Google Doc after the program. And all the education material as PPT and videos could be downloaded from there for future references. Questions and queries, if any, they could be put on the chat box. We shall take them one by one at the end of each presentation. Feedback forms also will be provided, and please fill them back and send it to send, give us give it give us give it back to us so that we, if they are lacunae, we would improve from there. Thank you and welcome everybody. Dr. Sujit.
Thank you, sir, for briefing about the program and the layout of this program. Before we start our program, I request all the participants to log in with their name instead of their phone and some other information is mentioned. This will help us gather the names of the participants who are attending this program. Then, as sir have already told you that any queries, please do forward it in the chat box. We will take the queries after each session. And regarding the feedback, please, a link will be provided in the Google Doc form at the end of this session. So kindly provide us a feedback. So first of all, we would like to begin with the decision-making tree for oxygen therapy, which forms the backbone of treatment for COVID patients. So Dr. Pratik Bais, Assistant Professor, Department of Anesthesiology, SGPGI, will be talking upon this very important topic. So Pratik, your screen is visible. I feel you may go ahead.
Yes, sir. Sir, am I audible?
Yes, you are audible. Yes.
Good afternoon, everybody. Good afternoon, Director, sir. Good afternoon, Sujit, sir, Anil, sir, and all the participants of this program, which we are starting. In this coming few minutes, we will be discussing about the oxygen therapy. Myself and Dr. Pratik Bais and Dr. Ashish Kanojia, sir, from my department, both of us are will be discussing about this oxygen therapy thing. So first of all, in this second wave of COVID, we have seen that how important oxygen is. And we should always remember that oxygen is a drug which doesn't have any substitute. When appropriately used, it is extremely beneficial. But when misused or abused, it is potentially very harmful also. Always while prescribing oxygen therapy to a patient, it should be prescribed by a doctor. It should clearly mention what shall be the flow rate, what shall be the device which shall be used, and what shall be the FiO2 which the patient should be given. In oxygen therapy, the clinical objectives, first of all, is to correct hypoxemia. Second is to minimize the symptoms of hypoxemia, if any. If the patient is having altered mentation or he's getting disoriented, then those symptoms should settle down. And third one is to minimize the cardiovascular effects of hypoxemia, like tachycardia, hypertension. So once the oxygen levels are sufficient for the patient, then these effects should settle down and patient should be hemodynamically more stable. We call patient a hypoxemic when his saturation is going more than 94%, or if we have done an ABG and his PO2 is showing somewhere around 60 millimeters of mercury or less on room air. The target for our oxygen therapy should be saturation more than 94% on room air, or a PaO2 of more than 60 millimeters of mercury when we are doing an ABG. 60 millimeters of mercury PaO2 resembles to 90% of saturation on room air. Of course, few populations, specific populations like pregnancy and in COPD patients, our targets do change. For COPD, the target should be between 88 to 92% of oxygen saturation at room air. And for pregnancy, it should be higher. We should target around 96%. The clinical assessment of patient includes features like tachypnea, tachycardia, or mild hypertension if present, and then the patient's mentation or the patient's status, like if the patient is having any restlessness, if he is confused, or if he is having disorientation, then these clinical findings should be assessed. For monitoring, we have saturation probe, which is commonly available in all the hospital setups, and ABG analysis if it is present in our COVID wards. Why we have different types of oxygen delivery devices? First of all, to provide appropriate oxygen therapy to the patient, I mean, providing right concentration and right flow to the patient as it is required, to know the progress of the patient. Like we can communicate within our community or our team that the patient yesterday, he was on high flow nasal cannula, or during past 3 or 4 days, the requirement has decreased. Now he is on NRBM mask, or it has further gone down to the nasal prongs. So we can communicate and we can know about the progress of patient. Then to help in the escalation or de-escalation of the oxygen therapy as and when required, to avoid oxygen toxicity, and most important, to avoid wastage of oxygen and to optimized use of the oxygen therapy. The oxygen delivery devices which we will be discussing will be nasal prong, face mask, Venturi mask, and mask with a reservoir bag. High flow nasal cannula and NIV will be discussed further by Dr. Tapas and Dr. Divya ma'am. Coming to the nasal prongs. Nasal prongs provide us oxygen. It is a low flow device with 2 to 4 liters of per minute flow prescribed through it. The FiO2 which it provides is 24 to 30%. It's a good device in the way that it doesn't hinder in eating, drinking, or speaking. It is very useful as a stopgap arrangement when the patient is undergoing physiotherapy or any investigation. Those patients who are having nasal obstruction or IELTS tube placement is there, in those it will be difficult to put in our nasal prongs. The side effect is there is dryness of the mucous membrane, especially of nose. So whenever we are using a flow greater than 4 liters, it needs to be humidified. And it's not good for the patients who are having, who are mouth breathers or who sleep with open mouth, or if they are having any pathology which is causing nasal obstruction. Then face mask. Face mask, in face mask, the flow rate which we use is 5 to 10 liter per minute, and the FiO2 which we can get is 30 to 60%. It has vents on the side, and when we exhale, the exhaled air goes out through this vent to the outer air or the ambient room air. We should keep it in mind that we should not give less than 5 liters per minute fresh oxygen or the fresh gas flow through this mask, because it can lead to rebreathing. That is, if we are giving less than 5 liters per minute, there will be mixing of the expired air inside the mask. And the next time when patient inhales, the exhaled air which is mixed there in the inside the mask, that can be inhaled and that can be problematic for patient. So to avoid rebreathing, we have to keep flow minimal at 5 liters per minute. The seal should be tight around the mask, around the face, and there is an elastic band also to make it tight. It is of course uncomfortable for the patient while eating or talking. Next is our Venturi mask. The flow rate in Venturi mask is 4 to 12 liters per minute. And the Venturi mask comes in different colors. It's color coded for different FiO2 which it provides. Like starting from blue color base of the mask, which provides around 24%. We can go higher to a Venturi mask, which is green colored, and it provides around 60% FiO2. The good part of FiO2, which is delivered here in the Venturi mask, is that it is fixed output device. I mean, the FiO2 doesn't depend upon the patient's inspiratory efforts. It works on Bernoulli's theorem, and it has air entrapment port to mix oxygen with the room air. Then comes our mask with reservoir bag or non-rebreathing mask. This is a very important device which is used by all of us in HDU, especially where the patient are needing high oxygen support. It is a device which is providing highest oxygen concentration. I mean, it doesn't need very much too high expertise in using this mask. And we can always use this as a savior whenever we have given call to a person from anesthesia or pulmonary. By the time he comes, or the different devices like high flow nasal cannula or BiPAP can be arranged. T till that time, the highest FiO2 which we can provide to a patient is by using this non-rebreathing mask. This is a very important device with two valves in place. One valve is the exhalation port, which is at the side of the mask, and the other valve is at the juncture of this reservoir bag with the mask. Both of this is are unidirectional in nature. So whenever the patient exhales air, that air goes out through this exhalation port to the ambient atmosphere. And whenever the patient is inhaling, he is inhaling from this reservoir bag, which is having highly enriched mixture, and almost 90% of FiO2 can be achieved if we are using this mask at high flow rates of 12 to 15 liters per minute. Then high flow nasal cannula, this is having two particular properties. First of all, the FiO2 can be controlled. Second, the air which is being provided or the oxygen which is being provided to the patient is both humidified and it is heated to 37 degrees centigrade. Otherwise, if we are using such high flows directly to the nasal mucosa or through the nasal prongs, there will be crusting and there will be sloughing of the nasal mucosa. So this device, what it does, it provides oxygen at very high flow rates, which is both humidified and heated. So summing up these devices, nasal cannula provides 24 to 30% of oxygen using 2 to 4 liters per minute flow. Face mask provides 30 to 60% with 5 to 10 liters per minute flow. Venturi mask, depending upon the Venturi mask which we have selected, we can achieve 24 to 60% of oxygen FiO2. From non-breathing mask, we can provide highest FiO2, that is 60 to 90%. And for this, we have to give flow from 8 to 15 liters per minute. Then HFNC, that will be discussed in the next discussion. The points to remember regarding humidification, especially that humidification is necessary for all devices and must in the situation where we are using more than 4 liters per minute flow of oxygen. There should be SOP for cleaning and maintenance of humidifying chamber in each HDU. Once water level is below the minimum mark, we shall always empty the whole bottle and fill fresh water in it. Humidifier should be washed in mild soap water and rinsed with clean water and dried before use. Once a week for the same patient and in between patients, all components of humidifier should be soaked in mild aseptic solution for 30 minutes. Then it should be rinsed and clean water with clean water and then it should be dried. Coming to the decision-making tree when we are providing oxygen therapy, depending upon the respiratory rate and the saturation which the patient is having, the patient's disease can be classified in mild disease, moderate disease, and severe disease for respiratory illness. If the patient is having a saturation less than 94, but of course more than 90%, and he is not tachypneic, I mean his respiratory rate is less than 24, and when we are doing ABG, we are finding that his PaO2 is around 60 to 70 millimeters of mercury. The device which we can use for this patient is nasal cannula. We can start flow of 2 to 3 liters per minute through nasal cannula. And if even N95 mask can be applied over it also, that is a good part. Or we can use a face mask. Generally, if the patient is maintaining 92, 93 also and his respiratory rate is settled, we don't provide oxygen until unless the patient is having a condition like cardiac or pulmonary illness or the disease, or if the patient is a child or if it's a lady who is pregnant. If the patient is having moderate disease, then our oxygen therapy devices come in use mainly. When the patient is having a saturation of less than 94% and he is tachypneic also, I mean his respiratory rate is going more than 24 per minute, then we shall go for an ABG to confirm hypoxemia. If ABG is showing 50 to 60 millimeters of mercury, The device which we can use is either a face mask with high flow or a Venturi mask or a non-rebreathing mask. A non-rebreathing mask with 8 to 10 liters of oxygen is the standard therapy which we are starting in these kind of patients. And then gradually we can titrate the oxygen therapy or the support. Then always we have to encourage a patient with mild disease or moderate disease or severe disease to go for proning and rotation to the sides or the lateral position. We have always seen that around 3 to 4% increase in oxygen saturation is achieved with proning or the rotation to the sides. If, say, a patient is having severe disease and his respiratory rate is going more than 30 per minute, in spite of this, patient is not able to maintain saturation less than, and his saturation is going less than 90%, or if we do a ABG and his PaO2 is showing less than 50 millimeters of mercury, then these patients are ideal candidates for starting high flow nasal cannula or NIV support or the pressure support therapy. Then we can later add proning and rotation to this therapy. So summarizing, for the patient with mild disease, either keep a close monitoring or provide oxygen with low flow device of nasal cannula, or you can provide it through low flows at face mask. If the patient is having any pregnancy or cardiac disease, anything, then of course we have to target it to a higher level. If the patient is having moderate disease, go for Venturi mask or NRBM. And if the patient is having severe disease, start therapy if available with high flow nasal cannula or NIV. And suppose if these facilities are not available there in HDU at that point, then start with high flow NRBM therapy. That is non-rebreathing mask with 15 liters of flow. With that, the FiO2 which we will be getting will be around 95%. And that should buy us time to arrange other modes of therapy. We have made a small case scenario. Say, suppose a 65-year-old male patient with complaint of fever for last 3 days has come to us, and he's having breathlessness for a day and his RT-PCR is positive, and he's having a respiratory rate of 28 to 30 per minute and saturation is 92. The therapy which we can start is either nasal prong or mask at 5 liters per minute. Say, suppose after half an hour or 1 hour, he's still having a respiratory rate of 32 and his saturation is not improving. In fact, it has worsened. Then we can increase our oxygen therapy and we can start a non-rebreathing mask with 12 liters per minute flow. And we can wait for 1 to 2 hours and see how the patient is responding. If suppose his respiratory rate keeps on increasing and his saturation is still in 90, around 90, then we can start with high flow nasal cannula at low flows, that is 40 liter per minute and FiO2 of 80%. Then we can review the situation after some time. If the patient's FiO2 if the patient's saturation has slightly improved, but the ABG is showing that the patient's PCO2 is getting built up in spite of high respiratory rate, then we can go for increased flow in high flow nasal cannula. Say we have increased it by 20 liters per minute and we have increased the FiO2. Now we can follow the ABG. If the ABG is showing that now the patient's breathing is getting settled, saturation has improved, respiratory rate has improved, and PCO2 has improved, then we can continue with our therapy and we can go for proning. Gradually, if the patient holds up, then we can de-escalate our oxygen therapy. While de-escalating, we should always keep in mind that first we have to de-escalate the FiO2, then we have to de-escalate the flow. If suppose our ABG showed that the patient's oxygen saturation is somehow maintained around 90, but his PCO2 is going higher to say 65 or 70, then it means that high flow nasal cannula is not the device for this patient and he needs positive pressure ventilation or assisted ventilation, and these patients should be ideally taken on NIV therapy with BiPAP or CPAP support. If the patient improves, well and good, we can de-escalate. But if there is further worsening, we can go for invasive ventilation and we can intubate and ventilate the patient. So this was, in short, summary of the oxygen therapy which we should initiate. Topics like HFNC and NIV will be discussed later in our other presentations. And this is all.
Thank you, thank you, Pratik. Thank you very much for this comprehensive talk. We haven't received any queries in the chat box. So just to reemphasize points which you have already taken up in your presentation, for example, many times we receive queries like a tachypneic patient comes. And so before we complete our evaluation, what will be your first choice of various oxygen therapy devices which we have discussed, so that in the meantime evaluation will keep on going, so you may apply it? What will be?
Yeah, sir, it's advisable that whenever a patient comes to us and he looks obviously tachypneic, or if the initial monitor reading is showing saturation less than 90 or less than 90, then we should always start our therapy with high flows with NRBM mask. It's advisable to start with NRBM mask, and gradually over time we can de-escalate therapy as if the patient starts settling. If his respiratory rates get settled, it comes to less than 24 per minute, or his saturation is going in 96-97% saturation range, we can gradually start de-escalating our oxygen therapy. But initial therapy which we shall start with shall be therapy with high oxygen flows, which gives immediate relief to the patient and is cardiovascular or any CNS symptom, if it is, then those things should settle first. Then gradually we can decide upon that what shall be the exact oxygen therapy which patient will need.
Thank you so much, Pratik. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Now we will move on to the next topic. Professor Alok Nath will be discussing the SGPGMS COVID management protocol. Boss, you may share your screen, please. He is head of the Department of Pulmonary Medicine, and he will be discussing this topic.
Thank you, Sujit, and good afternoon to all the participants. Core of management, that is the oxygenation therapy, has been very nicely and comprehensively covered by Prati. I'll be just discussing the management protocol in general. What is the COVID management protocol according to the current scenario and current recommendations? I hope I'm audible and my screen is visible to all.
Yes, sir. Your screen is visible. Up audible. You may go.
So, to begin with, I will start with the management at the triage, which includes the patients who are RT-PCR negative patients, or the category which has been included as the presumptive patients. So, all patients presented to the institute with acute febrile illness with suspicion of COVID should be primarily admitted and evaluated at the designated triage. In our institute, we call it as T3. COVID-19 should be suspected as a possible etiology in all patients presenting to the institute with severe acute respiratory illness in current scenario. That goes without saying that the standard infection prevention and control measures should be implemented at all times. All healthcare personnel should be donning full PPE in these areas. And immediate sample collection for COVID-19 swab for RT-PCR as well as TrueNAT should be taken, and patient should be managed in the triage itself. If RT-PCR is positive, then patient should be transferred to the COVID ICU or the isolation ward, wherever it is applicable according to the severity of illness. And in all patients, baseline investigation, that is complete blood count, renal function, liver function tests, a random blood sugar, a coagulogram, a baseline chest x-ray, urine examination, inflammatory markers like ferritin, CRP, procalcitonin, D-dimers, and fibrinogen should be obtained. All patients with acute febrile illness with respiratory failure, with respiratory localization of the illness, empirical therapy should, with the broad spectrum antibiotics, should be started according to the standard guidelines of management of community acquired pneumonia, according to the risk factors and underlying comorbidities, and according to the local antibiotic policy. All patients who have suggestive history, that is highly suggestive history of COVID, that is influenza-like illness and hypoxemic respiratory failure in these times, should undergo HRCT thorax if the condition permits, and CORAD scoring should be done. If CORAD scoring is more than or equal to 4, empirical remdesivir, according to the protocol, that is 200 milligram loading followed by 100 milligram OD for 4 days, prophylactic dose anticoagulation with enoxaparin, deltaparin, or retaparin should be started, and these patients should also be administered dexamethasone 0.1 to 0.2 milligram per kg body weight or any equivalent molecule, awaiting the RT-PCR reports. So the summary is that all the cases of presumptive COVID-19 with the who are presenting to any center should be given the benefit of doubt, and treatment according to the protocol for management of COVID should be followed. Adequate hydration should be maintained in all these patients. Oxygen supplementation should be started initially with nasal prongs, and Pratik has already described in very great detail the decision-making tree for implementing oxygen therapy to these patients, which should be followed. And a cautious trial of CPAP, that is non-invasive ventilation, should be given. CPAP, BiPAP, or BiPAP should be given, because the therapeutic window in hypoxemic respiratory failure is very small. And as and when it looks like that the patient is going into fatigue, or patient is unable to maintain saturation, a timely intubation and mechanical ventilation should be instituted in all these patients. The conventional ARDS NET strategy, that is a low tidal volume, high PEEP open lung approach, should be utilized or used in these patients. Other modes of ventilation, which are still newer modes, like pressure regulated volume control, etc., also can be used, but the most common and the mode which has got the most evidence for these patients is conventional ARDS NET strategy. And if the RT-PCR turns out to be negative in these patients, repeat samples should be sent. And if there is a high index of suspicion, these patients can be managed in the COVID area. That is, they can be transferred out of the triage to ICU or isolation ward, whichever is applicable. So now coming to the clinical management protocol in confirmed cases of COVID, the Ministry of Health and UP government are in the process of revising. In fact, they have revised in various government orders from time to time regarding the management of mild cases now. The basic principle which should be incorporated in the management strategy from the at the state level is that there should be a establishment of 24 helpline with a competent volunteer to assess the severity of disease and identify patients who are candidates for home isolation and hospitalization. They should be prescribed appropriate medications, and they should be given monitoring protocol and should be made aware of red flag signs. So this is the a kind of hierarchy which is being set up in the state so as to minimize the unnecessary hospitalization of mild cases. So the severity is classified as mild, in which patient has got uncomplicated upper respiratory tract infection with the presence of symptoms like malaise, headache, or generalized weakness. These patients do not have any symptoms of pneumonia, suggestive of chest lung infection. That is, respiratory rate is less than 20. Saturation is more than 94 on room air, and if available, X-ray is normal. There should be no laboratory investigation. There are no laboratory investigation recommended in patients with mild illness. So one should avoid asking for a lot of investigations to be done in mild illnesses, and the patient should be reassured that these investigations are not required at this point of time. And use of HRCT thorax, which is rampant in milder cases also, should be discouraged. coming to the moderate disease, patients who have the features of category A, however, they have a respiratory rate of more than 24 or saturation of less than 94 on room air, or chest X-ray showing bilateral heterogeneous or homogeneous opacities, or any of the two of the following laboratory criteria are fulfilled, that is CRP is more than 50 but less than 100, ferritin is more than 500 but less than 1000, D-dimers between 50 to 1000 or IL-6 more than 5 to 10 times the upper limit of normal, or the CT criteria is showing a CT severity score of 8 to 17. These patients are categorized into moderate disease. The severe disease is categorized in patients who have all the features of category A and B, but they have respiratory rate of more than 30 per minute or saturation of less than 90 on room air. Chest X-ray is showing findings of COVID pneumonitis, or they present with hemodynamic instability or alteration of consciousness. Similarly, any of the two of the following laboratory criteria in which CRP more than 125 or ferritin more than 100, D-dimer more than 1000 or IL-6 more than 10 times the upper limit of normal, or the CT severity score is more than 18. This is classified as severe disease. So coming to the management of mild disease, is now recommended to be managed primarily at home. So the patients with milder disease should be isolated at home. All the infection prevention control measures should be applied and should be the family should be educated about it. The pharmacological therapy according to current protocol is tablet ivermectin and azithromycin for first 3 days, followed by tablet doxycycline from day 4 to day 10. Sorry, there is a typographical error here. From day 4 to day 10. Supplementation by vitamin C or zinc and vitamin D should be given for 7 to 10 days. Plenty of fluids, regular monitoring of pulse oximetry and temperature monitoring is advisable, or it should be strictly followed to find out any early sign of deterioration so that early corrective steps can be taken. However, if in the patient with mild illness, if the patient is persistently febrile beyond 5 to 7 days or saturation is less than 94 for at least half an hour, measured in two different fingers, use of outpatient use of glucocorticoids may be advocated for 3 to 5 days only. The molecules of choice are dexamethasone, 6 milligram once a day, or its equivalent doses of methylprednisolone and prednisolone, which is 32 and 40 milligram respectively. If the condition doesn't improve in 24 to 48 hours, a nearest COVID hospital should be contacted for admission. Patients who have risk factors for severe illness, that is uncontrolled diabetes mellitus, ESRD, decompensated chronic liver disease, should be monitored very closely, and they should be told that even with the earliest sign of deterioration, they should be rushed to the hospital so as to avoid any catastrophe. If these people develop worsening symptoms such as mental confusion, difficulty in breathing, persistent pain or pressure-like sensation on the chest, cyanosis, features of dehydration, that is decreased urine output, etc., they should be immediately referred for hospitalization. Coming to the category B, that is the moderate disease, these patients should be admitted to HDU or ICU. IPC protocols should be implemented at all times. Oxygen support should be started to maintain a saturation of 92 to 94%. And unnecessary or injudicious use of oxygen should be avoided to minimize oxygen shortage. Oxygen supplementation, again, Prateek has already covered. It should start with nasal prongs, followed by high flow devices to maintain saturation, desired saturation. Awake should proning should always be implemented wherever and whenever possible with the standard protocol of 30 minutes of proning followed by 30 to 120 minutes of left lateral, right lateral, and supine. Similarly, vitamin C, zinc, and vitamin D supplementation should be given to all these patients, and symptomatic treatment with the antipyretics, management for pain, or use of antitussive medication for cough can be added. anticoagulation. Prophylactic dose of unfractionated heparin or low molecular weight heparin should be given to patients with moderate disease. However, LMWH is contraindicated in ESRD in presence of active bleeding, or a patient is being going to be taken up for emergency surgery. In all these patients, after ruling out the risk for bleeding, anticoagulation should be started in prophylactic intensity. Steroids are advocated to be used in moderate disease. IV methylprednisolone 0.15 to 1 milligram per kg, dexamethasone 0.1 to 2 milligram per kg for 5 to 7 days to be started as soon as possible. However, the duration and dose should be titrated as per the clinical and radiological response. But here I will underscore, in view of increasing incidences of secondary infections, especially fungal infections, prolonged use of corticosteroids and unjustifiable doses of corticosteroids should be best avoided. Remdesivir should be administered to all these patients who fall under the window period, that is about 5 to 7 days. It is best administered if the patient has presented to you within 7 days of onset of symptoms. However, people do use within 10 days also, according to the protocol. Empirical therapy with the broad spectrum antibiotics may be given according to local antibiotic policy, because many of these patients do have secondary infections also. A follow-up inflammatory marker should be done at a frequency of about 48 to 72 hours. A complete blood count renal and liver function test may be monitored daily according to availability of investigations. Now, coming to the newer anti-inflammatory therapy like baricitinib, which has recently come up in a large trial from NEJM, in which more than 1,000 patients with hospitalized with COVID-19 were given baricitinib plus remdesivir or placebo, and it was seen that the time to recovery was lesser in these patients, in patients who were administered baricitinib. But overall, the findings of the studies suggested that there was an ordinal scale. This is the ordinal scale of COVID-19 severity, in which people who are falling in category 5 and 6, that is, neither they are too sick, neither they are too stable, they should be hospitalized. They should be requiring supplemental oxygen with or without the use of high flow devices or non-invasive ventilation. They were the patients who got the most benefit with baricitinib. However, it should be understood that baricitinib is basically kind of replacement for corticosteroids. Co-administration with corticosteroids is usually discouraged in patients who are given baricitinib. So this was based on this trial, and now it is advocated that patients who have early disease, that is early moderate disease, should be considered baricitinib along with remdesivir, who have progressive symptoms or progressive hypoxemia, to prevent intubation and mechanical ventilation. However, these therapies should be individualized and practiced under expert supervision. Similarly, the pre-existing anti-inflammatory therapy, which we are all aware of, that is anti-IL-6, tocilizumab, should be considered or may be considered in patients who have progressive hypoxemia despite the standard management protocol, that is remdesivir, steroids, etc. It should be, and a patient is having features of cytokine storm, that is CRP is progressively rising, ferritin is doubling within 24 hours, and you have ruled out secondary bacterial infection as a cause of rise of inflammatory markers, tocilizumab may be considered. It may be life-saving at times, and we have been able to save several mechanical ventilations and intubations with the help of tocilizumab. But it should be employed well in time, and infection should be carefully ruled out. In moderate patients with moderate severity, patients should be closely monitored for increased work of breathing, presence of hemodynamic stability and increase in oxygen requirement. And if all any of these three are experienced, patient should be immediately transferred to the ICU. It goes without saying that all the patients who are admitted to the ICU may experience an episode of secondary bacterial infection. So timely consideration of empiric antibiotic therapy as per the local antibiotic policy and antibiogram guidelines for older people, immunocompromised patients, or children less than 5 years of age should be instituted. Convalescent plasma, however, the available evidence says that it is not useful in patients with COVID-19, but still the Minister of Health and Family Welfare, and there are still several reports that if used in time, it may still be useful. So if the patient is presenting within 7-day illness and you have availability of plasma, because nowadays plasma harvesting has being almost very less because of lot of vaccination and lack of evidence of convalescent plasma on paper. So as per availability, convalescent plasma may be given if the patient is presenting in early moderate disease within 7 days of illness. Coming to last, that is category C, a cautious trial of non-invasive ventilation should be given because the therapeutic window in hypoxemic respiratory failure is very small. And arrangements for backup for mechanical ventilation should always be kept ready before attempting NIV. HFNC or NIV has been shown to be of benefit in preventing intubations when patient with very high oxygen requirements. However, these patients should be monitored very closely for signs of HFNC or NIV failure and timely intubated so that for optimal outcomes. A conservative fluid strategy should be used in patients with ARDS where there is no evidence of shock or volume depleted state. Corticosteroids in patients who have mechanical, who have impending respiratory failure requiring mechanical ventilation, a pulse of methylprednisolone can be considered in these patients who have got impending respiratory arrest, or you anticipate that these patients, this patient might require mechanical ventilation within a few hours or maybe within 24 hours. High dose methylprednisolone therapy can be used, that is 250 milligram for 3 days if the inflammatory markers double and the patient has got progressive sign of deterioration with impending chances of intubation. Otherwise, the standard therapy for corticosteroids is the same, that is methylprednisolone in a higher, slightly higher dose, that is 1 to 2 milligram per kg body weight, or dexamethasone 0.2 to 0.4 milligram per kg for 7 to 10 days. And a dose may be tapered according to radiological involvement and clinical recovery. As similar to moderate disease, as I've already told, that the evidence is more for patients who have got, who are not mechanically ventilated, but rescue therapy with JAK1 or JAK2 inhibitors, JAK1 or JAK1/2 inhibitors, or ILT-IL6. May be instituted with judicious, with careful judgment after ruling out significant bacterial or fungal infection. Remdesivir is advocated in category C, that is severe patients also. Control of comorbid condition and appropriate use of antibiotics is advocated here also. Coming to anticoagulation, therapeutic dose of anticoagulation with the unfractioned heparin or low molecular weight heparin after ruling out the high risk of bleeding should be instituted in patients who are shock or triple therapy with the thiamine, vitamin C and hydrocortisone should be instituted. That is the patient who are on steroids, it should be converted to hydrocortisone because the mineralocorticoid activity of hydrocortisone is maximum among all the corticosteroids. Mechanical ventilation should be instituted if there is persistent hypoxemia, increased work of breathing, or development of hemodynamic instability. The conventional ARDS net strategy should be used. Proning or recruitment maneuvers as per the availability of expertise and manpower may be instituted in case of refractory ARDS. So thank you all for patient listening. This is all about, in short, about the COVID management protocol.
Thank you, Professor Alok, for presenting this complicated management protocol in a simplified manner. We have few queries for you. So first of all, how long we can continue oxygenation by HFNC? So is there like duration specific or?
No, there is no specified duration for continuation of HFNC. Hypnonasal cannula can be used for till the patient, you are able to wean the patient off the hypnonasal therapy. However, the care which has to be taken in patient who require prolonged use of HFNC is that the humidifier and the cannula, which the disposable cannula which is used, should be cleaned, and one should be not using normal saline or any other fluid in the humidifier. You should be using only distilled water. If distilled water is not available, even RO water the water, the mineral water can be used, but avoid using normal saline, Ringer's lactate, DNS, etc. for that, because the wrong, incorrect use of humidifier may be or is associated with high chances of infection, secondary infection, bacterial and fungal both. So one should be careful with the humidifiers and the accessories, that is the cannula, should be carefully seen if any physical damage or sign of contamination is seen. A frequent use of the accessory, not the tubing, the cannula which is there in the front, the small attachment, that should be changed as and when necessary.
Okay. Well, there is an interesting query from Professor Anil that would you like to revise the dosage of zinc in view of mucormycosis situation?
There is, sir has rightly pointed out, there are some, reports that zinc does propagate the growth of mucormycosis, the fungus, fungal infection, especially mucor. But whether or not therapeutic supplementation of zinc is actually behind it still remains investigational. So because the amount of evidence which was there for zinc supplementation and vitamin C supplementation for management of COVID-19 itself was very, very weak, and these recommendations are being followed as per the advice of Ministry of Health and Family Welfare and the UP state guidelines. Mm-hmm. We continue to keep it there, but we would definitely like it, as I pointed out in my presentation, that it should be not continued more than 7 to 10 days or the maximum of 2 weeks. That's all. After that, a healthy diet or a balanced diet is more important rather than pumping multivitamins and all these things. Sir has correctly pointed out that overuse and unnecessary use of these drugs should be discouraged.
Okay. The last query is this is also pretty interesting. Dr. Bhanu from SSPH PGTI Noida. If after 10 to 14 days of starting DEXA plus Enoxa, the patient still has same oxygen requirement in D-dimer and CRP are still high, how to manage DEXA Enoxa further? And we faced this situation several times. And another similar query that was that how long we can continue steroids and enoxaparin in severe COVID?
It is, the condition is separate for both the things. Enoxaparin, DVT, that is the prothrombotic management of prothrombotic state associated with COVID-19. Enoxaparin or deltaparin or any other low molecular weight heparin should be continued for all patients who are hospitalized with COVID-19, whether they are in moderate category or they are severe category. The severe category patients are advocated to be given therapeutic dose, for deltaparin it is 5,000 units subcutaneous BD, and for enoxaparin it is 60 milligrams subcutaneous BD. till the patient is hospitalized, patient will require thromboprophylaxis. That is for sure, and that is that goes without any doubt. However, if your D-dimers continues to be high, it should be on therapeutic dose. If you start therapeutic dose on day one and by day 15 your D-dimers values, or day 20 your D-dimer values comes down, and your patient is also gradually improving, you can come down to prophylactic dose. But prophylactic dose will continue till discharge, and in certain situations, as I happened to tell in various interactive sessions during the version one of the COVID teaching program which SGPGI was hosting, that there is a scoring system of that is improved VTE score, in which patients anybody who has a score of more than 4 or equal to 4 should be given extended thromboprophylaxis after discharge also for 4 to 6 weeks. So there is no doubt that all patients who are hospitalized should be continued on prophylactic dose heparin, but the severe patients will require therapeutic dose followed by prophylactic dose once the acute inflammatory phase is over or the D-dimer values have come down considerably. But in conditions which you have asked, that if the D-dimer continues to be very high means more than 1500 consistently, then your the therapeutic dose anticoagulation should continue, because thrombotic disease has been confirmed without doubt in patients with severe COVID. So that is there for heparin. Coming to steroids, for patients with steroids, maximum duration after 10 days of corticosteroids or maximum 14 days of steroids, you should start tapering rapidly, because after 14 days of corticosteroid, there is no utilization of corticosteroids for prevention of fibrosis or alleviation of hypoxemia, except in certain situations where you have radiological evidence of organizing pneumonia pattern on HRCT in the recovery phase, where 1 mg/kg body weight of corticosteroids might be required for a longer duration, which is about 4 weeks. After that, you have to taper. But in majority of patients who have refractory, which have persistent hypoxemia, you should concentrate on oxygenation delivery devices and upscaling of your oxygen supplementation, rather than concentrating on increasing the dose of corticosteroids, which is only associated with increased chances of secondary infection and nothing else. So steroids should not be continued or should not be administered in higher doses after 14 days, 10 to 14 days, and you should start tapering after 10 to 14 days. And should be tapered off rapidly, seeing the reason obvious that everybody is aware of rising incidence of severe fungal infection, both Aspergillus and Mucor in patients, which is being partly attributed to injudicious use of corticosteroids.
Thank you, boss. Thank you very much for your wonderful presentation. Now we will move on to the next topic. Dr. Tapas will be presenting how to operate HFNC, high flow nasal cannula. So Dr. Tapas, you have already shared your screen. I feel you may go ahead.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon, everyone. Yeah, I'll be speaking briefly about how to operate a high flow nasal cannula. Now, high flow nasal cannula in oxygen therapy lies in between non-rebreathing mask and BiPAP. It is kind of a bridge in between. Now, the premise of high flow nasal cannula is very simple, that as a patient gets hypoxic, his inspiratory drive increases. So with the high flow of gases, we are trying to meet his elevated inspiratory drive, that a peak inspiratory flow reaches around up to 30 to 120 liters per minute. So we are trying to decrease the work of breathing for that patient. So we use high flow. Now, when, as Pratik sir already told in his lecture, that humidification is very important. So when we are using such high flows, it is paramount that we humidify the gas. Otherwise, there will be desiccation of nasal mucosa, and loss of nasociliary function, which will lead to further complications. So we give high flows. In order to ensure the humidification is proper, and in order to ensure there is no loss of heat through when high gas flows pass through the wet respiratory mucosa, the gases are also heated, and all these things are given through a nasal cannula. Nasal cannula is different from the routine nasal cannula. It's slightly more chubbier and longer than a routine nasal cannula, but it basically resembles a nasal cannula. So hence the name is HFNC. Now HFNC combines the advantage of nasal cannula. That is, the patient is more comfortable, patient can talk, patient can do proning comfortably, he can eat, drink properly. So compliance is as good as a nasal cannula compared to BiPAP. However, the advantage of HFNC over a routine nasal cannula is that we can give higher nasal flow, higher gas flows, and higher FiO2s. In BiPAP, the advantage of HFNC is that it has got better compliance. Patient is more comfortable compared to a BiPAP. And HFNC, while does not give same amount of PEEP as a BiPAP gives or a respiratory support as a BiPAP gives, but if the patient is not keeping his mouth open, that is, he's not speaking and he's keeping his mouth closed, then it, due to the virtue of high gases, it provides a PEEP of around 3 to 5 mm of HE. So it kind of does some amount of recruitment for the patient also. So HFNC lies in between. It is superior to NRBM with the concomitant benefits, but it is slightly, it is inferior to BiPAP in providing ventilatory support, but the patient compliance is better. Now indications of HFNCs are many, but in context of present scenario and for the sake of simplicity, we all know the most important and relevant indication is hypoxic respiratory failure or type 1 respiratory failure. So how do we go about starting the device? Later in my talk, there is a video where I'll show you how to set up and use the device. Here we will talk about the general strategy. As the patient gets hypoxic, it's always better to start with the maximum settings. Make sure the patient is responding to HFNC. And if he is responding to HFNC, then slowly titrate the settings. So we start at higher flows. Depending upon what kind of machines you are using, maximum flows can be 60 to 80 liters. In Fisher-Paykel, the maximum flow is 60 liters. In RespiCare, the maximum flow is 80 liters. So start off with a maximum flow setting. Start off with the highest FiO2, that is 100%. Start off with the lower temperature, because straight away going up to 37 degrees centigrade might feel uncomfortable for some patients. So start off with a temperature of 34 degree. And when the patient is comfortable, he understands, grasps the idea what HFNC is, how it is working, then you can gradually increase up till 37 degrees centigrade. Then carefully monitor the patient. Look for, usually in a hypoxic COVID pneumonia patients, please give it at least 1 or 2 hours for before deciding if the patient is not improving. How do we decide the patient is improving? Obviously, the respiratory rate will settle down. It will come down to less than 25. The SpO2s will start picking up. And if we have access to ABGs, the PF ratio will rise. And obviously, there will be no hypoventilation. Hence, the PCO2 will also fall. Now, this duration, how long we should monitor a patient on of COVID pneumonia when we put him on HFNC before we decide whether he's improving or not, is very dynamic. It depends on the clinical scenario. Suppose if you have put a patient, hypoxic patient on HFNC, there is not even arrest in his deterioration. The slope of deterioration has not even has been reduced. So SpO2s are still in the range of less than 90, the patient is grossly tachypneic, he's losing consciousness, then obviously you will terminate the HFNC trial and shift him to a higher oxygen therapy modality like BiPAP or intubation, mechanical ventilation. So in an optimistic scenario, if our patient is improving, that is the respiratory rate is settling down, SpO2s have started picking up, then first decrease FiO2 by 5% till we reach FiO2 of 40 to 50%. Once we have reached an FiO2 of 40 to 50%, then start to decrease the flow by 5 liters per minute till we reach a flow of 15 liters per minute. Once we reach the flow of 15 liters per minute with a FiO2 of less than 40 and the patient is comfortable, is maintaining saturation, then we can think about weaning the patient off HFNC and shifting him to a conventional non-rebreathing mask. Now, obviously, not all patients will respond. So how do we know that patient is not responding? There is treatment failure for this patient. Clinically, the respiratory rates will never settle or will even worsen. Patient will keep on or start using accessory muscles. Patient will become, you can clearly see that patient is becoming fatigued. There will be increase in oxygen requirements. In severe cases, there will be deterioration in sensorium and even his hemodynamics will deteriorate. SpO2 obviously will be below 90%. And if we are doing ABGs, we'll see the PO2s are on the lower range, that is less than 50 or 60 mmHg, and the PCO2 has started accumulating. What are the common problems? The most common problem is wrong insertion of nasal cannula. Please make sure that the nasal cannula is attached properly to the patient, the harness is there in the place, and the nasal prongs are not jutting towards the nasal septum, or they're not jutting outside the nasal cavity. Please make sure the nasal cannula itself is free of all obstruction. And there, sometimes what happens, there is some encrusting over the nasal mucosa, which covers the opening of the nasal cannula. So make sure that nasal cannula is properly inserted and there is no obstruction in between. Most of the times when the HFNC starts, patient might complain of some amount of discomfort. Usually the sensation is new. So it is always important to counsel the patient beforehand. And since a lot of high gas flows are going in, it is always advisable to apply HFNC only when the temperature, that is desired temperature, that is 34 degree or 37 degree centigrade, has been achieved. When we switch on a HFNC machine, usually it preheats the circuit. So please apply the HFNC when it has been preheated, if the clinical situation permits. If the patient is still complaining of discomfort, look, always go back and check whether the proper flows, which you have flow temperature and FiO2, which have been set, are getting actually delivered to the patient, or if the patient requires higher flow or higher temperature or higher FiO2s, and decide accordingly. Low oxygen alarm, then again, check the connection, check the flow meter, check the central oxygen pipeline pressures, check for any circuit block or kink. Sometimes what happens, due to a lot of humidification, there is condensate in the circuit. Then this condensate can also act as a obstruction. So please make sure that circuit is free of the condensate. Empty water bag is again a problem. The machine will immediately sound an alarm if water bag is empty. Then we have to make sure that a fresh bottle of RO or distilled water is attached to the humidifier chamber. And we sometimes what happens, due to reuse, the humidifier chamber develops a crack in between while we refit it. So sometimes the water leaks from there, and we have to make sure that humidifier chamber is snugly fitted and there is no cracks or leak in it. Sometimes the machine will display a number showing system failure. Most of the times, if we switch off the machine and let it cool for 3 to 5 minutes and restart, the problem is addressed. If machine keeps on showing system failure, then obviously we'll have to contact engineer and rectify the problem. Right, so now this is a video where we will set up the machine and
start this machine. As well, kind of risky care. This is the machine, how we will receive it. Back of the machine, this is the oxygen supply inlet pipe which we get connected to the wall-mounted oxygen supply. This is our oxygen flow meter. As we can see, the oxygen, we can at max get an oxygen inflow of 50 liters per minute. This is the power button. This is the alarm silent button. This is the settings button, the button with three lines on it. And this is the rotatory knob with which we will select the parameter and confirm the parameter. This is where, this is the part where our humidifier chamber will go in. So this is the machine. Now moving on to the parts of the machine. We will get a, open the machine bag, we'll get a big bag. This big bag will contain the tube and the chamber kit. Open it. This is the humidifier chamber. And this is the connector. How will fit it? You press this lock and slide the humidifier chamber inside. With this sound, we will be sure that our humidifier chamber is now in its place and the lock is there. If we want to take out our humidifier chamber, we'll again press the lock and pull it like this. It will come out. Again, we'll start it back in its position. So now the humidifier chamber is in its place. This I will add will get connected to a bottle containing distilled water or regular RO water. It is important to note that we are not supposed to use normal saline or single lactate with it because it will cause too much flaking in the humidified chamber and will affect the performance of the machine. So you will imagine that we have connected our IV line to the distilled water bottle. It is very important to note that we have to open this air inflow valve so the negative pressure inside the bottle doesn't get created too much. We have to keep it at the open position. Now, once we have installed the humidifier chamber, this is the heated breathing circuit. This gray part of the machine, the gray end of the breathing circuit will attach to the machine. This triangular part will correspond to the triangular part here on the machine. We will press the lever like this and we will press it and leave the lever locks. Now it's completely flat. This is the patient head on which we will attach the manual cannula.
Here, near the patient end and in between the nasal cannula, we can attach a HME filter. And this HME filter will prevent the contamination of the main circuit. While we, and for each patient, we have to use a fresh nasal cannula.
The nasal cannula of the packet. Question, fix it tightly. Nasal cannula will be fit to the patient. And what we see here is a harness to fix this whole nasal cannula and the breathing circuit of the patient. Now, breathing circuit is ready. We will connect the power cable. Power cable gets attached. You can see here, power cable gets attached here. Power cable is attached. We will again rotate the machine. Connect it to the power source. As soon as we connect it to the power source, the machine gets switched on. It's showing here is a standby right now. These are the four buttons. This is the start and stop button. This is the alarm silent button. This button with three lines is the settings button, how we choose our settings. And this rotatory knob is used to select or to confirm a particular setting. We long press the power button for 3 seconds and it starts. It's showing it is preheating the circuit. So, as it is slowly increase the temperature of the circuit. Now we want to change the settings. We press the settings button, we reach the settings. For choosing the any particular setting, we have to first press the rotary knob. We have selected the the nasal cannula's flow settings. On this, we will again rotate. We will select the mode. node can be adult and adult and children both. For adult, the flows are from 10 to 80 liters. For children, the flow will vary from 2 liters to 25 liters. Once we have selected the kind of patient we have, we will move on to the flow. We will, let's say I'll keep a flow of 60 liter per minute. From there, we'll move on to the temperature. Let's say I have selected a temperature of 37 degree centigrade.
As everybody can notice, there is no oxygen FiO2 settings in the screen, because the FiO2 is set by adjusting the flow meter, that oxygen flow meter. So that thing we have to eyeball while manipulating the oxygen flows. We have to adjust the desired FiO2.
So the temperature of this breathing circuit will be at 37 degrees centigrade. There is an additional setting to choose the setting. Regarding the level of humidity. There are actually three settings in it. Humidity can be +1, +2, +3, or it can be again -1, -2, -3. If we notice that there is too much collection of water in the breathing circuit over a period of time while we use it, we will choose a lesser humidity setting, that is -2, -3. Or if you are happy with it, then we will choose a 0 setting. If the patient complains that he is air is pretty dry or there is too much nasal congestion, we may increase the humidity of the gas inflow by choosing the humidity setting. Default setting is 0. Now we can also choose the alarms. Oxygen too high.
Now, there is no button for setting the FiO2, but there are oxygen alarms. So please, for oxygen too high, always keep a value which you want to give to the patient. Suppose you want to give a FiO2 of 80%, please choose that oxygen too high. So if at all, because the respiratory requirement, the inspiratory conditions and the respiratory drive of the patient might keep on changing. So what might happen, what is initially 60%, then it might, the delivered FiO2 might increase too much. So keep your oxygen too high alarm at the level which you think is some, which you have chosen. Anything, if the oxygen delivered is higher than that, then the machine alarm will sound.
Too low. Blockages. This can be, this button can be used for alarm reset. Again, this is for the clinical set and the language. This is for returning to the previous main menu. For stopping the gas flow, again we have to press for 3 seconds. It is telling us to high flow nasal cannula of respirator.
Oh, I'm sorry.
This is the of this breathing circuit will be at 37 degrees centigrade. There is an additional setting to choose the setting. Over a period of time is there is too much nasal congestion. Again, this is for the clinical set and the language, and this is for returning to the previous main menu. For stopping the gas flow, again we have to press for 3 seconds. It is telling us to close oxygen. Once we press it again, it goes into a standby mode.
Thank you everyone for your time. I'll be happy to take any questions.
Thanks Tapas for this wonderful description of the HFNC. And Professor Anil has praised your presentation. He liked your presentation very much. And he has also shared one query that do we have a different assembly set for children as we are having maximum flow of 25 liters?
Yes, sir. There are pediatric nasal cannulas are different. From adult nasal cannula. For adult also, there are actually three nasal cannulas, large, medium, and small.
Okay.
For each nasal cannula at the back end, there will be maximum flow written. We usually get Fisher-Paykel nasal cannulas here. So if you look at the back end, there will be maximum flows written for what flows they are meant to be.
Okay. There is one question from a doctor from GMC Kannauj. The name is not written. So, sir, tell the HFNC requirement in children.
Sir, usually we start the flow at 1 liter per kg per minute. And then we reach up till 2 liters per kg per minute. And usually the flow rate in for pediatric is in our respiratory care HFNC, the maximum flows which you can give is 25 liters per minute. So usually it's 1 to 2 liters per kg per minute in starting off. And obviously we'll use the clinical, the grunting should get reduced, accessory muscles should get reduced. The
usage one practical query that how do you decide the requirement between NIV or HFNC in a particular case? I always tend to confuse in this regard that how do you pick any one thing between NIV and HFNC?
Sir, I believe if the deterioration is gradual, you feel the respiratory discomfort is not too much, patient is not too much tachypneic. This saturation is falling. It was 96 at say 15 liters per minute of NRPM. Then gradually it is dipping down till 90s. Now you have started thinking that, okay, fine, we need to step up our oxygen therapy. In those scenarios, HFNC works well. It gives quite some time for us to avoid the use of BiPAP. Patient is able to do the physiotherapy, patient is able to do the awake proning and other respiratory recruitment measures. So in that way, HFNC is better. Nutrition is well maintained compared to NIV. When the deterioration, what I have seen is when the patient arrives at our hospital late, patient is already too much tachypneic, patient is having a heart rate, respiratory rate of 50, saturation of 74. In that scenario, I don't think it's really advisable. I, as a clinician, prefer to use NIV in those scenarios when the patient is much more comfortable and when I'm able to wean down the settings to a respectable level, say, at a PS of 8, he's generating good tile volumes. His oxygen requirement is also at 50%, and he's getting. Then I will switch him on to HFNC, or maybe I'll do the Dutch. I will while he's taking his breakfast and all, I will give him a HFNC trial during that time. And if he's tolerating, we can increase the periods up to 4 hours and alternate with NIV, because HFNC cannot match the recruitment advantage of NIV. So intermittent NIV can still be used along with HFNC, and a patient is also much more happier that way.
One last query from Dr. Mukul Saxena, MRAMC, Ambedkar Nagar, that in how many days should we change nasal cannula, circuit and humidifier for a patient?
Sir, humidifier, as long as there is no visible crusting and it's intact, you can use it. Same goes for the circuit, because circuit is also very costly. It's a heated circuit. It's not something you can get it randomly. So keep that circuit, especially in our government setup, please keep that circuit carefully, because it has got an integrated heater in it. It's not just normal silicon heated circuit. Okay. Circuit. For nasal cannula, if it's, well, it's not blocked, if the harness is still there, if there is no kinking of the prongs, then you can use it as long as it is maintaining its shape. If there is some blockage which cannot be removed, then the this thing. One thing in between, the humidifier, that HME filter which you are using, please make sure that it gets changed between 12 to 24 hours. Always put a date on it and make sure that it gets changed, because sometimes obstruction is in the HME itself. So we'll get distressed due to that.
Well, thank you, Tapas. Thanks a lot for your wonderful presentation and nicely presented answers. Thank you. Now we move on to the next topic, that is how to operate BiPAP. Dr. Divya Srivastav, Associate Professor, Department of Anesthesiology, SGPGI, will be taking this topic. So Dr. Divya, you have already shared your screen. We can see.
Am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible. You may go ahead, please.
Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. I'll be dealing with the topic, how to go about administration of BiPAP or bilevel positive airway pressure to patients suffering from respiratory distress because of COVID-19. Now, taking you back a few lectures, what is the point when you decide that this patient requires a BiPAP? It is when optimal requirement of NRM or HFNC, whatever is available in your institute, is unable to actually maintain oxygenation in the patient, or the patient is able to maintain oxygen levels, but the carbon dioxide levels are continuously rising with each ABG. That is the time when we start thinking about what is called as assisted ventilation. Now, assisted ventilation can be delivered in non-invasive methods or by intubation and invasive methods. NIV or non-invasive methods are preferable to be tried first before going to the invasive methods. One contraindication, although, will be if the patient is unconscious. If the patient is unconscious, intubation is a better idea than going for non-invasive ventilations. Now, BiPAP or non-invasive ventilation can be delivered either by specific non-invasive ventilation delivering machines or by utilizing your ventilator, the standard ventilator, which is available. Some terminologies before I'll go to the setting up of the ventilator is IPAP or inspiratory pressures or PSV. This is actually the pressure support which the machine gives to the patient. The amount you increase IPAP or PSV will actually lead to increase in the tidal volume of the patient and therefore will help in reducing the CO2 levels in that particular patient. EPAP or PEEP is the expiratory positive airway pressure. It enables you to keep the alveoli of the patient open after expiration and helps in increasing the oxygenation or SpO2 values of the patient. Next two things that we need to set in a BiPAP machine or ventilator is the FiO2, amount of oxygen ranging from 21 to 100, and the mandatory rates. That is, if the patient fails to ventilate himself below the rate, whatever we have set, the machine will take over and start ventilating the patient. So any BiPAP machine will require you to set these four parameters: the upper pressure or the inspiratory pressures, maybe known as PSV when it comes to ventilators, PEEP or expiratory pressures, FiO2, and mandatory breaths. Now coming to the mask. Non-invasive ventilation is delivered through a mask of this type. There is a harness behind the mask which enables you to tightly fit the mask to the patient. How do we know what is the appropriate size of this mask for a particular person? This mask is triangular in shape and the apex of the triangle should be fitting at the nasal bridge. The lower half of the triangle should be between the lower lip and the chin of the patient. This and either side should completely cover the patient's nasal airs and the lip of the patient. This is a full face mask device. In market, we also have nasal CPAP devices which will cover only the nasal portion of the patient. Now, how do we fit the circuit in a BiPAP machine? At our institute, we have the machine by ResMed, and this is the video taken from this particular machine. In order to start fitting the circuit, first of all, we would need this T-piece connector. This T-piece, one end of it goes to the machine. The other end is connected to the hose pipe provided. The other end of the hose pipe, we fit in a one side valve is provided by the company. The other end of the hose pipe is fitted to the valve. One thing which we need to see is that there is the mark of a man or a patient made over here. This mark should be towards the patient end. If we fit this valve in an opposite direction, this valve is a one-way valve, and the CO2 which is generated by the patient, it goes out through this valve. So it is very important that we fit it in a proper direction. Now this valve goes into your non-invasive mask here. The circuit is ready to be used. The mask will be put to the patient. Now, if we are using this particular machine with this circuit alone, we need this end, as we can see, is open of the triway. So this end needs to be occluded. And then this machine is good to go. If there is nothing for you to occlude this end, we can simply do away with this tri piece and the hose can be directly connected to the machine. This is where we switch on the machine and you can straight away start delivering the patient with non-invasive ventilation. Now, if we wish to monitor the FiO2 levels with this particular machine, this tri piece comes in handy. There is a device provided by the manufacturers. You simply place the device in one end of the T-piece. A cable is provided. The appropriate end of the cable goes into the device and the other end goes into the BiPAP machine. Here, the other end will go behind on the hind side of the machine. Here it is, and this is the place where you provide the oxygen connection to the non-invasive ventilation machine. So this is how you can use it and use the machine with FiO2 monitoring. Now, how do we actually use this particular machine? We need to know how to switch on the machine. After connecting it with the AC connector, at the hind aspect of the machine, there is a small switch on point. We simply press the point and the machine switches itself on. It takes a few minutes. The machine takes a few minutes to start up. We need to wait for that particular time. Now, if anyone is not aware about the settings or how the machine setting is to be done, one simple measure to start the therapy in the entering period is simply by pressing the button provided just below this big button. Here it is. If we press this particular start button, the machine will start delivering at whatever the setting was at the time when the machine was previously shut off. This particular machine had previous settings of 11/4 and it has started delivering with the inspiratory pressures of 11 and expiratory pressures of 4.8. This is the monitoring screen and there are 8 such screens provided. If we press this lung button, we would get to know the different, we'll come to the different monitoring screens. The second screen, it tells us about the tidal volume of the patient. This is the most important screen as far as monitoring of the particular patient is concerned. This tells you about the tidal volume of the patient, the respiratory rate, minute ventilation, and any leak in the circuit. This particular machine was not connected to a patient, and that is why we are seeing a leak of this sort and a respiratory rate so high. There are other screens too, which we can simply by pressing the lung button, we can simply move on to other screens. We'll get the different volume loops, the tidal volume, synchronization, and oximetry. Now, if we desire to change the setting of this particular machine, we need to unlock the device first, as we can see that the device is locked. To unlock the device, we need to go to the settings button, and then we need to press the setting and the center button, larger button, simultaneously for a few seconds. A pop-up comes that this machine will be inactive for a period of 5 minutes or 120 minutes or unlimited. We particularly choose a 5 minute setting time, and after which the machine becomes active to be used. The mode usually set is the ST mode. ST mode is the spontaneous time mode. That is, the machine allows the patient to breathe spontaneously at IPAP and EPAP set by you. And simultaneously, there is a backup rate too for patients who fail to ventilate themselves below the rate set by the clinician. So the mode is set. Next, by simply rotating the big button, we move to the IPAP. By pressing the button, we can change the whatever BiPAP labels we decide, ranging from 10 to 20. Then there is expiratory pressures. We change it ranges from 5 to 10 as required by the patient. The backup rate is set. And once whole of the setting is done, once all this, I'm sorry. Once whole of the setting is done, by simply this pressing the on-off button, the therapy begins. The therapy is initiated. How do we know? By going to the monitoring button, we'll be able to see this green line moving up and down. It means the machine is delivering the therapy to the patient. Now to switch off the therapy. By pressing the on-off button, the therapy is switched off. That is, the machine is no longer functional. And in order to switch it off electrically, we simply press the switch off button and the hind side of the machine and the power is down. The machine gets switched off now. So this is how we'll deliver the BiPAP by use of a non-invasive ventilation machines. Now, if we desire to use your particular ventilator for delivering non-invasive ventilation to a patient, we again come to this basic requirement of a non-invasive mask. And this is how we'll fit our circuit for using the BiPAP machine, non-invasive ventilation with the ventilator. We'll require a T-piece, the usual T-piece available everywhere. The white portion of the T-piece is disconnected and one end of it is connected to the mask and the other end is connected to the circuit. we can apply a HME filter. We should rather apply a HME filter at this point. And here we can see the circuit is ready to use. That is, we can use the this is how we can utilize this circuit for non-invasive ventilation by means of a ventilator. Now moving on to setting up a ventilator, we can see the mode button. By pressing the mode, a pop-up comes up. We select the non-invasive ventilation. Move to the non-invasive ventilation, press the switch select button, and we move to non-invasive ventilation. PSV or inspiratory pressures are set. Expiratory pressures or PEEP is set. The FiO2 preferably 100% is set in the beginning, and then you can titrate down as per the patient's requirement. The respiratory rate is set ranging from 12 to 18 as per the patient's requirement. And once the center button is pressed, the machine starts delivering non-invasive ventilation. Further changes can be made without interrupting the therapy. For example, here we can see that this particular PSV of 10 is giving a tidal volume only of 213. We desire a higher tidal volume. We'll simply go to this PSV button by the use of the select device. Press this buttons, PSV will be selected. Change the value by 2, increase it by 2, 12. And then again by pressing it, we'll be able to see the next tidal volume. Similar in this way, we can actually set the device appropriate for that particular person. Now switching off the therapy. To switch off the therapy, we simply need to press the mode button. The machine will show us a warning sign that do you want to go on standby. You press the select button and the machine goes to the standby mode. So this is how we switch off the therapy. With this, we have come to the end of the presentation. All the best, and I'm ready for any questions.
Divya, thanks for this wonderful presentation and demonstration of all those wonderful videos. So crisp and very informative. Well, I have a personal query for the sake of discussion that how do you, especially during the phase of de-escalation of therapy, how do you decide, how do you do de-escalation of NIV parameters?
NIV parameters, to begin with de-escalation, first of all, FiO2 require, if it is 100%, we gradually reduce the FiO2 depending upon the SpO2 values or PaO2 as available. Preferably, we go by the ABG values if it is available by PaO2 values. First, we'll decrease the FiO2, then we'll decrease the and PEEP simultaneously. Like for 100% FiO2, the PEEP usually kept is 8 to 10. Then, if the patient is enabling a very good PaO2, that is above in the range of above 80, we decrease the FiO2 by 10, make it 90. Still, the patient is maintaining, we come to 80. Next, we will start reducing our PEEP levels till 8. Then next, we'll reduce it to 60. So basically, we go by the ratios of PEEP and FiO2. After FiO2 reaches to 60, we can start reducing the PEEP till we come down to 5. Once we're at 5 PEEP, which is a physiological PEEP, we gradually reduce FiO2 to 40. And then with the patient might be ready for NRBM trial next.
Okay.
By the NRBM device. And then similarly, we go for the PaCO2s, that is with IPAP. If the PaCO2 is being maintained by the patient, we gradually decrease the IPAP by 2, see the PaCO2 values in ABGs. As the patient is responding, we keep on decreasing it. And once we are able to maintain a ventilation, a good ventilation at a IPAP level of 10, the patient can be moved to non-invasive NRBM.
Thank you, Divya. Thank you very much for your wonderful talk. Now, before we move on to the next talk, I would like to share that I have already shared the links for the feedback form and the educational material which we are discussing in this program. So you may go to those links, you may download the educational material, and also do please provide us the feedback of this program. So it will help us in improving this program. Now, moving on to the next topic, as Dr. Divya was also mentioning, ABG interpretation. ABG is very useful in determining that how much should we increase or decrease our oxygenation therapy. So Dr. Farzana shall be discussing this important topic. Dr. Farzana, you have already shared your screen. I'm seeing your slides.
Good afternoon, everyone. Am I audible?
Yeah, a little bit louder would be wonderful.
Good afternoon, everyone. Am I audible?
Yeah, sure. Go ahead, please.
Good afternoon. I'm Dr. Farzana, Senior Resident Anesthesiology, and we would be discussing briefly about EBG and its interpretation. So EBGs, you know, these are the most repeated tests done in the COVID ICU. Why do we need to do it so frequently? What do we gain of doing an ABG? You know, the basic aim in our COVID setting, in our COVID scenario, is to know about the oxygenation and the ventilation status of the patient and to guide the management of the patient accordingly. So apart from the oxygenation and the ventilation status, the ABG also tells us about the acid-base status of an individual. Now, severe respiratory acidosis, metabolic acidosis, or alkalosis can cause deleterious effects on various organ systems. For example, if the patient has got acidosis, it can cause myocardial suppression and hyporesponsiveness of the vasopressor agents. So the timely detection and correction of these disorders can improve the hemodynamic status of the individual. And then we also know about the electrolyte status of the individual. The acid-base status may also alter the electrolyte levels, which are critical to the patient's status. For example, the patient with acidosis can have hyperkalemia, and the patient with alkalosis can have hypokalemia, both of which can be deleterious to the patient. And then there are few values which are directly measured and few values which are derived. For example, the electrolytes, the lactates, the anion gap, and the hemoglobin. These are not directly measured, but these are derived values. These may not exactly correlate with the lab values, but trend of these values may guide in the management of the patient. Now, coming to the interpretation of ABG and how to read an ABG. The first and the foremost thing is we need to take a relevant clinical history. Like in any other test, we need to take a short relevant clinical history and correlate the ABG clinically. And then we need to mention the FiO2 and the mode of breathing. Now, I'll come back to this point in the later slides. For simplification and ease, we divide it into cluster, the cluster one and cluster two. The first cluster is pH, PCO2, and bicarbonate, which tells us about the acid-base status of the individual. And the second cluster comprises of PO2 and PCO2, which tells us about the oxygenation and ventilation of the individual. And then we look at the electrolytes and the other derived values. So, we would be discussing about the second cluster first, which is the basic aim of this presentation. That is the oxygenation and ventilation cluster. So for the beginners, let me emphasize that oxygenation and ventilation, these are two different aspects of respiration. The PO2 value tells you about the oxygenation, and the PCO2 value tells you about the ventilation. The normal PO2 varies with age. The formula H by 4 plus 4 can tell you the arterial alveolar gradient. But it is quite cumbersome to calculate in each patient. So we take a cutoff value of 80. A patient with a PO2 of less than 80 and SpO2 of less than 94% on room air is considered hypoxemic. And provided the patient has a normal PCO2, that there is no CO2 retention, we would require oxygenation devices in this patient. So we would begin with nasal prongs. As discussed in previous presentation, the nasal prongs can be used in the flow of 2 to 5 liters per minute, which could provide a maximum FiO2 of 40%. Then next, we would step up to face mask with flow of 5 to 10 liters, which could provide an FiO2 of maximum of 60%. And then next, we would go for non-rebreathing mask, which can be used up to a flow of 10 to 15 liters according to the respiratory rate of the patient, and which could provide a FiO2 of around 80 to 90% theoretically. Just looking at the PO2 cannot tell you about the exact oxygenation status of the individual. Suppose a patient is having PO2 of 70 with nasal prongs at 2 liters per minute, and a patient is having a PO2 of 70 with NRBM at 10 liters, there is huge difference in oxygenation of both the patients. So now here we introduce PF ratio, that is PaO2 by FiO2 ratio, and we need to calculate the PF ratio to know the exact oxygenation status of the individual. We categorize the patient into mild, moderate, and severe ARDS according to the PF ratio. PF ratio of 200 to 300 is mild, 100 to 200 is moderate, and less than 100 is severe with a PEEP of 5. The patient who has a PF ratio of less than 150, requiring an FiO2 of more than 60%, in falling into moderate to severe category of COVID, these patients should be encouraged for awake repositioning or proning. Coming to the PCO2 values. Now, the PCO2 values tells us about the ventilation. If the patient is hypoventilating, the patient will have CO2 retention and type 2 respiratory failure. These patients, apart from oxygenation, they require ventilation as well. So if the patient has PO2 of less than 60 with a PCO2 of more than 45 to 50, that is the patient has respiratory acidosis, will require ventilation, has ventilatory failure and will require ventilation. So we could go either for an invasive ventilation or for a non-invasive ventilation. So how do we decide that should we go for invasive ventilation or non-invasive ventilation? The patient has signs of respiratory distress with a PF ratio of less than 200 with CO2 retention and PaCO2 of more than 45. We need to go for ventilation. So if the patient has got a life-threatening condition, or if the patient is in shock or coma, is not able to protect his airways, in such cases, we would like to go for an invasive ventilation. And in rest of the patients, we would go for a non-invasive ventilation. So ABG criteria, apart from the clinical parameters for invasive ventilation, include a PaO2 of less than 40, PaCO2 of more than 50, and pH of less than 7.25 to 7.3. So ABG also guides us for weaning from invasive ventilation. And the ABG criteria includes a PaO2 of more than 60 and PaCO2 of less than 50 with an FiO2 of less than 0.5 with a PF ratio of more than 200 and PEEP of less than 5. The patients falling in these criteria can be weaned off from invasive ventilation. So coming to the second cluster, that is the acid-base status, which includes the pH, PCO2, and bicarbonate. So the normal pH is 7.35 to 7.45. For simplification and ease, we use a cutoff value of 7.40. And the normal PCO2 is 35 to 45. We take cutoff value of 40, and the normal bicarbs are 22 to 26, and we take a cutoff of 24. We would like to go in a stepwise approach in this cluster. And first, we will look at the pH values. Now, if the pH value is less than 7.40, we would categorize it as acidemia, like in this ABG. And if the pH value is more than 7.40, we would consider it as alkalemia, like in this ABG. So after the pH, the dictum is always look at the PCO2 values before looking at the bicarbonate values. So we have considered a normal PCO2 of 40. If the pH decreases and the PCO2 increases, the cause is respiratory. And if the pH increases and PCO2 decreases, that is the change is in opposite direction, the cause is respiratory. And if it is in the same direction, the cause is metabolic. Here, I would like to introduce a mnemonic rooms. That is, respiratory goes in opposite direction, the change of pH and PCO2. And in metabolic cases, the change is in the same direction of pH and PCO2. For example, here the pH is 7.31. That means the patient has got acidosis. And now we need to know the cause. And PCO2 is 53. That means there is CO2 retention. So and the pH has decreased and PCO2 has increased. The change is in the opposite direction. That means the cause is respiratory and the patient has got respiratory acidosis because of CO2 retention. Now, coming to metabolic cause. Metabolic cause, the change in direction is in the same direction. So pH decreases and bicarbonate decreases. The cause is metabolic acidosis. If pH increases and bicarb increase, the cause is metabolic alkalosis. Coming to compensation, there are two dictums here. One is that body never overcompensates. The second is the bicarb and PCO2 always move in the same direction. That is, the compensation is always in the same direction. Suppose there is a case where the compensation is not in the same direction, like in the third ABG, that indicates that the patient has got a mixed disorder. There is acidosis with CO2 retention. That means there is respiratory acidosis. But in this case, the bicarbonates should increase for compensation. Rather than that, the bicarbonates are decreasing. That means there may be an additional metabolic cause and there is an additional metabolic acidosis in this case as well. Coming to electrolyte and ion assessment, this is beyond the scope of this discussion. We would just mention the normal values of sodium, that is 135 to 145, potassium 3.5 to 4.5, and calcium 0.25 to 5 millimoles per liter. And lactate is 5 to 10 milligrams per deciliter. And these are all derived values, not directly measured. We would like to discuss few ABGs, few examples. And the first is this ABG. And the patient is on nasal prongs at 5 liters. And the PO2 here is 52. And the saturation is 75. The patient is hypoxemic. We need to step up and we would put the patient on face mask. So after changing the oxygenation device, are we satisfied? So we have changed, we have changed the oxygenation device and we have put the patient on face mask and the patient has saturation of 98 now at a PO2 of 116. We could get down on the floors, and also when we would calculate the PF ratio in the first ABG, the patient has got a PF ratio of less than 130. Any patient with a PF ratio of less than 150, we need to advise for awake repositioning and proning of the patient. This is another ABG. The patient is comfortable and is talking on room air. That is FiO2 of 21%. And the ABG shows a PO2 of 29 and the oxygen saturation of 52. It is always important to correlate the ABG clinically with the patient's status. So this may be a false ABG or a VBG which is not being taken properly. This ABG shows that this is a patient who is on face mask at 10 liters and the PO2 is 92 with a saturation of 97. And in this patient, we could start weaning and we could actually decrease the oxygen flows to maintain a PO2 of around 70 so that the saturation is around 94 and that would be sufficient for the patient. Any queries? Thank you.
Well, thanks, Farzana, for your nice presentation, because it's quite a difficult topic and finishing it up in 15-20 minutes is really a challenge. So one practical query that we usually face is that supposedly on the basis of ABG or rather on monitor, we change oxygen therapy, we increase supposedly oxygen support. Then after how much time should we carry out an ABG to support to think that the changes would have been made?
It actually depends upon the status of the individual, you know, but ideally we get an ABG after an hour. After any change in the ventilatory settings or the oxygen flows, we get an ABG after an hour to see whether it has reflected in the changes have reflected in PO2 and PCO2, and we adjust accordingly.
Okay, Farzana, thanks a lot. Thank you very much for your talk. Now, the last topic of this capacity building program. Dr. Rafat shall be discussing practical tips for initiating vasopressor infusion. I would like to thank Rafat for waiting till the end because this is the last topic. So, Rafat, you have already shared your screen. We can see your slides.
Good afternoon to everyone. Today I shall be discussing about the practical tips for initiating inotropes or vasopressor. I am Dr. Rafaz Shamim from Department of Anesthesiology. I will be covering the topic as the commonly used inotropes, how to prepare these inotropes, and when to use these inotropes, and some practical tips. Now, the commonly used vasopressors which I will be dealing is adrenaline, noradrenaline, and vasopressin. So first of all, I will be talking about adrenaline. It comes in an ampoule of 1 ml, and each ml contains 1 milligram. So an ampoule of adrenaline has 1 milligram in a 1 ml solution. Next is noradrenaline. It comes in an ampoule of 2 ml, and each ml contains 1 milligram. So an ampoule of noradrenaline contains 2 milligram. But one thing which has to be noticed is that in the ampoule of noradrenaline, it is written as noradrenaline bitartrate 2 milligram, which is equivalent to noradrenaline 1 milligram. So an ampoule of noradrenaline has 2 ml and it is equivalent to total 2 milligram. Third is vasopressin. It comes in an ampoule of 1 ml and each ml contains 20 unit. So a 20 unit per ml ampoule is there for vasopressin. So summarizing these, noradrenaline, it comes in 2 ml ampoule and it contains 1 milligram per ml. Adrenaline comes in 1 ml ampoule and it contains 1 milligram per ml. And vasopressin comes in 1 ml ampoule and it contains 20 units per ml. Now, how to prepare these vasopressors? For preparation of noradrenaline and adrenaline, it remains same that we have to mix the drug in 5% dextrose or normal saline in a 50 ml of syringe. For preparation of this, how much drug has to be taken in milligram? For this, we have to multiply body weight with 0.03 to get a single strength solution. If like the body weight of a patient is 70 kg, on multiplying with 0.03, it comes to be 2.1 milligram. Roughly, if we take 2 milligram ampoule, and if we run this at 1 ml per hour, the concentration which it would be delivering will be 0.01 microgram per kg per minute. And if we run it at 5 ml per hour, this will be 0.05 microgram per kg per minute. Similarly, if we have to increase, there is increased requirement of vasopressor, and we have to increase the noradrenaline and adrenaline. For this, we can change it into 10th strength or septic strength. For this preparation of drug, we have to multiply body weight by 0.3. If the body weight is 70 kg and we multiply it by 0.3, it will come around 21 milligram. So roughly we will have to take 10 ampoules of noradrenaline to make a 10th strength or septic strength. And if we run this at 1 ml per hour, this will be give a concentration of 0.1 microgram per kg per minute. And if we run this at 4 ml per hour, then this will be around 0.4 microgram per kg per minute. And the dose of this noradrenaline or adrenaline is 0.01 to 0.4 microgram per kg per minute. And similarly, how to prepare a vasopressin? An ampoule of vasopressin has 1 ml, which contains 20 units. And it has to be mixed with 5% dextrose or normal saline. And when mixed with a 20 ml of solution, this will contain 1 ml, will be equivalent to 1 unit. And if we run this at 1 ml per hour, then this will give a 1 unit per hour. And the dose is 0.02 to 0.04 unit per minute. And when we multiply it by 60, then this will give in R. So 0.02 multiplied by 60 is equal to 1.2, and 0.04 multiplied by 60, it comes out to be 2.4 ml per hour. And how to use these vasopressors? Norepinephrine or noradrenaline, it is the first line of drug to be used when the mean arterial pressure of a patient is less than 65 mm of mercury. And if on increasing this norepinephrine dose and its MAP is not getting maintained, then vasopressin, it is the second line agent after titrating norepinephrine dose if target MAP has not been achieved by norepinephrine alone. Now, if a MAP of patient is 65 milligram is not achieved with a noradrenaline at a rate of 1 ml per hour, that is a septic strength, 10th strength, that is equivalent to 0.1 microgram per kg per minute, then simultaneously we have to add vasopressin, one ampoule of 20 units in 19 ml distilled water, and we have to start this at 1.2 ml per hour, that is the dose of 0.02 unit per minute, and we can increase this up to 2.4 ml per hour, that is 0.04 unit per minute. Now, the some practical steps which has to be taken care while administering these vasopressors. We have to use infusion pump so that these drugs can be administered as a continuous IV infusion. And always we should label the drug concentration and dilution, like single strength or septic strength or 10th strength, or we can use how many milligram in how much NS or D5 which we are using. And central line is the preferred mode of administration of these vasopressors. But transiently, if there is no central line and patient MAP is falling, then we can give through peripheral IV line, but it should be transiently in a transient period only, as giving through peripheral line, IV line through a long period, that can cause tissue necrosis there. And one thing we have to also see that we do not administer soda bicarbonate or any other alkaline solution through an IV line containing norepinephrine, because it can inactivate, the inactivation of norepinephrine may occur. And we have to avoid abrupt withdrawal, as this vasopressors have very short half-lives of around 2 to 3 minutes. So avoid abrupt withdrawal should be avoided, and we should titrate the infusion accordingly. Thank you very much for your patient listening. If any queries.
Well, thanks for this very crisp talk, because we have purposefully kept this talk very simplified so that the basic purpose of the vasopressors is achieved. We haven't gone into the theoretical aspects and other complicated issues. One query which I have personally is that could we use, regarding vasopressin, could we use it along with norepinephrine, or it has to be used separately from norepinephrine, like whenever this situation comes?
I could not get.
For example, you said that the indication of vasopressin is that when MAP, sufficient MAP is unable, we could not achieve the MAP with norepinephrine alone. So would you like to use it alone? You stop norepinephrine and then you start vasopressin, or you tend to add vasopressin to norepinephrine?
We have to add over the norepinephrine. It is the second line, and when the along with norepinephrine at a dose of 0.1 microgram per kg per minute, when we are not able to maintain a MAP of 65, then we have to simultaneously add vasopressin to achieve the required MAP.
Okay, fine, Rufat. Thank you very much. And we have reached towards the end of this program. And before we leave this program, I would like to thank all the faculty members who have participated and all the participants who have come to attend this program. And also I'm thankful to Mr. Vijay Yadav, who from our director office, who always organized this program with a wonderful smile. And it's a very difficult task to organize these kind of programs, but I always I've never seen him putting any complaints, so I'm really thankful to him. And before we leave, I would like to repeat that I have already shared all the PPTs in a PDF format in the Google Drive link. The link has been shared in the chat box. You can download all the PPTs and videos. And also I have shared a feedback form link. So it would be grateful if you can provide a feedback of our program. Well, thank you very much. We are ending this program.